name's Rob Green. I'm the web developer at Rod Library at the University of Northern Iowa. I started a program this past semester as part of my master's program through UNI's Instructional Technology Master's program. We had to choose a project that tied into something we had a passion for. For me, it was science fiction. So I wanted to see how could I create a program or adapt something that was existing to teach lessons. And for me, particularly being interested in leadership and teamwork, I wanted to focus on that. So the end result was this Make It So leadership project. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about the process that I used for it, the way that the program works, and then not necessarily to try to sell you on Artemis, but to give you an idea for how you might adapt some sort of a commercial game or system for educational use as well. So the reason I decided to go with the Starship Bridge Simulator for my project was I wanted to have an environment that allowed us to have multiple people together working with information that each other person, everybody else needed, and then to do it in a controlled, safe environment. So of course, simulation is great for children. And then even trying to do lessons for a group, like say a corporate setting or other areas where you don't have a lot of time with them, I wanted something that could be loaded up very quickly, didn't take a long time to set up or deploy, and then could be folded back down quickly. So that's what we've got up here on two different ship controls. And I can usually launch it in about 2 to 3 minutes as long as I've got the PCs together. So I also wanted to do something that visibly was high pressure, that wasn't just say like an economic simulation game or something that's a little more sedate. I wanted to see stuff blowing up. So in this scenario, we have tactical nuclear weapons. So you can't really get more high pressure than that. It's very immersive when you turn off the lights and you've got your consoles together and it's dark. You've got a big helm screen, a master control panel up on the screen. So it really looks, especially in the dark, looks like a starship bridge. So it's an incredibly immersive environment. We're using pop culture references that kids especially can relate to. My kids are obsessed with Voltron and Star Wars, so I can get them connected to this right away. It's something they can understand. And then also, the nice thing about one with a starship is we're not really catering to one particular field like medicine through an emergency room simulator or construction with like a more corporate or a construction-based safety simulator. This is totally outside of the realm of what people normally do, so it's very agnostic toward individual industries. So. The inspiration for me, or the reason I wanted to do this, was I have about 10 years experience working in shipboard simulators like this through my Coast Guard experience. As an officer at the Coast Guard Academy, we trained on these kinds of simulators for a good 4 years, going from just a freshman at the Coast Guard Academy, where you're having to just get the sense for the navigational controls and understanding how the different components of the ship work together, how to work the radio, all the individual technical components of the ship's bridge. So by the time you're a senior, you've moved up in the ranks and you're now in command of the ship. And so you have to organize the work of the people underneath you. You have to keep them working as a team. So I wanted to have that kind of experience available for civilians as well. And so seeing the successes that we've had at our Merchant Marine Academies and Naval and Coast Guard Academy, I thought, let's do the same thing for teamwork training, decision making, and even stress management as you're dealing with high pressure environments here in the civilian world. So jumping right into Artemis and how it works is you've got this area, especially depending on how you set up your controls, you've got a helm station, weapons, engineering, science, and communications. And the real beauty of it is it's kind of like Rock Band, where each person has their own control, but then the captain has to sit back and doesn't get controls. The captain has to take in the information and provide instruction and direction to the individual crew members. And as I'm seeing with my 10 and 8-year-old, it's not this like sitting down, you get to be in charge kind of position. It's tough being the captain. And so they've gone from jumping at the chance to be the captain to instead wanting to just be weapons or be helm. And they make me be the captain. So it's a challenge, but as I'm developing their skills and their knowledge, I'm seeing that they're now starting to want to get back into that captain role. So technically it looks like this. I'm gonna have this bridge set up with my own laptop being the view screen and the server so we can project that. And then you have to have a minimum of weapons and helm. And then if you have the people, you can also add in a science officer, an engineering officer, and a communications officer. But if you don't have that many people, you can combine their stations into weapons and helm, and it just gets a little bit busy, but it's definitely doable. So you'll see when I'll have these laptops set up, and you're welcome to come up and I'll demonstrate it to you. But each station has their own views and their own things that they're responsible for. So up at the top is the helm officer, and that takes the commands from the captain and moves the ship around. Then you have a main view screen. You have the weapons officer who gets all the nukes and homing missiles and also controls the shields. And then my favorite position, engineering. So this is where you're Scotty. And you get to work fairly independently because the captain doesn't have the time to tell you every little tweak to make to the ship's engines and the shields and everything. But when you're good at it, you can make adjustments on your own and say, "Captain, I've given you full power shields," and if you can do it in a Scottish accent, even better. So I'm still working on it. I sound more like a hobbit, which would be kind of cool. A hobbit engineering officer. I'll have to work on that.
Small quarters.
Yeah, much space. I can get my hands on anything. So then the last is the science officer, and that station has the whole view of the map. It can see where all the enemies are, can see the bearings and ranges to them. And so that person is a really important position to let the captain know where to go. And then the last one, which isn't showing on here, is the communications officer, who is really in charge of taking the information in that's like these little prompts coming from the game that says, the Deep Space Station 9 is under attack and needs help, or they have supplies that have to go to this ship. So you go up and you rendezvous, you take the supplies, and you've completed that mission. So within about an hour's time span, which is what I found is my kids' attention span for it on any given night, the missions will probably complete 5 or 6 mini missions and then get to the point where we're about to take on an enemy armada and like, "Oh, time's up," and they go, "Dad, no." So we're working on seeing what it would be like for us to do a 2-hour or longer scenario. But looking at just the hour-long sessions, these are the kinds of things that I'm talking about with my own kids and with the students that I'm having come up to you and I. We run this every other Thursday night at Bob Library, and I'm doing it primarily just to get more data and more information about the best way to run the bridges and the best kinds of lessons to pull from the students. So some of those really important questions for a 10, 8-year-old that we can talk about after is, how do you be an effective leader and a follower? What sorts of skills do you need to have, not only to lead, but also to work for a leader, to be useful in your position, and to be as much a contributing member as possible? We also look at different leadership styles, and that's a part where I would love to get more help from potentially other teachers and other people who understand child leadership or young adults, what their leadership needs and styles are, because there's so much opportunity to talk about somebody who's maybe a passive leader but still effective versus somebody who's very aggressive in their leadership styles. Maybe still is effective, maybe isn't. You could be turning off your crew members by just constantly micromanaging them. On the other hand, maybe they need that kind of extra instruction. So those are the sorts of things we talk about. And then how to deal with stressful situations appropriately it's surprising to see how much that comes into play in the game. Because, like in the case of my daughter, she'll sit in the captain's chair, the ship will start veering toward a black hole, it will be sucked in, there's no way of escape. She'll jump out of the chair and run out of the room. Like, "Honey, you can't abandon the bridge. Your crew's counting on you." So she'll sheepishly come back and sit in the chair, and she won't give any orders. Like, okay, we're going to have to work on this. We're going to have remedial lessons. And then finally, that critical role of communication. Because the way that the game was programmed, each person has information that other people don't and that they need to in order to do their jobs. A great example is enemy ships have a certain, it's called a frequency, for their shields. So there's going to be like, your science officer will scan an enemy ship, takes a few seconds, they get additional information. One of those pieces is it's like a little chart that says, okay, A through E frequencies of their shields are high, but D is kind of low. So you can tell, the science officer can tell the weapons officer, hone or tune our beams to frequency D, that's their weakest, and it'll destroy them faster. So it takes a while to get to that level of training where they're working together and not having to have the captain tell them everything. But when they do, it's like something clicks in my kids' minds, like, oh, it's like an empowerment that they get. Like, I have this data. And I think, well, what other things in life does that apply to? Homework assignments that you have, or even doing chores in the day. Like, you know something that your kid, that the other sibling doesn't know. How can you use that? So we're trying to continually find ways to tie this information into their day-to-day life. So this is generally what it looks like. We took this at RodCon last year at the library. So we have stations set up, and I've got them, I think there's like 32 computers in the room, and I've got them assigned on different consoles around the room. Because the cool thing about it is, as you can see here, you can set up multiple ships on the same server. And so these guys are in a little scout ship, and they're actually fighting people who are in the ship up ahead. So I find that my kids love it the most when they're head-to-head against the enemy ship. And you can also tie it not just into the same building, but you could be fighting with some other ship across the country if they have a bridge as well. You just give them the same server address. So again, there's the larger console view, and you can switch your boards to show the main, like the battle map or the view screen in front. I'm going to show you that in a moment. And as I'm looking at this, and Rod Library, fortunately, is very supportive of this program, even though we do a little bit with college students as a morale exercise. I am kind of focusing more on the K through 12 level. So my hope is that we can tie it into some of the educational learning and gamification that we're doing, these kinds of studies, so that as we explore how to make this sort of a experience more useful. We're wondering, do we use a different simulator? We're certainly not wedded to Artemis Bridge Simulator. So is there another one that might be more useful? Star Trek just came out with a VR bridge experience that I'm really interested in taking a look at. Although I've got concerns that if you have goggles on and you're seeing this virtual environment around you, you're not getting the visual cues of the other people. You're seeing like the fake version of them. So I really do think that there is a value in actually eyeball-to-eyeball contact with the people around you. And then, you know, along those same lines is, would it make sense to have our maker group build us a real bridge, a physical bridge? Because rather than having laptops that we're using now or desktops, we could put them on tablets and have touchscreen displays and really get some of the immersion that we're looking for with this. So for the costs of it, if you're buying it commercially or just buying it as a game, it's $60 or $40 for six licenses, which is still a great deal. But also on the website, it says that it's free to educators. So you could mainly it's writing the programmer and saying we have the educational use for this, and then it'll provide the free license. I just paid the $40 and picked up because it's such a good game, I want to support it. So I do have the ability, like if you wanted to download it, I can do that for you. You can see what that looks like. Otherwise, I can bring us right into the spaceship, because it's the end of the day, and we want to blow stuff up. So I'm going to close down here. And launching Artemis is just a matter of you have the icon on your desktop. I'm going to tell it full screen, 1680.
Are there varying levels of difficulty?
There are. And I'll show you that when the map starts.
Because I would think that, like with your daughter, if it was something, you know, if the level of stress is so high she has to run out of the room, maybe if there was something that was a little bit, and I don't know how you would do that when you're interacting with other people.
Yeah, you can do that in the simulator. You can say, I'll show it here. I'm going to start the server. And in a solo game or a player versus player game, I can say the difficulty level overall, and I can say what kind of terrain. So maybe there's no black holes, or maybe there's no friendly ships. So that you can kind of tweak it that way. So that's the server level. And then I'm going to put this bridge down here. So on the subsites, I just put in the same IP address. Okay, so now this one's ready to go. Who wants to come up and drive? All right, Ali's dangerous. So Ali's ready to go here. You'll be my helm and my engineering officer. So you're ready to play. So it'll just take a moment when I put this other one in. Doc, you're going to be my helm.
Oh, I am. Okay.
Yeah, I'll bring it back to you. This is full service here.
So you'll be helm and science.
So if you've got a room full of students and they're all one-to-one, they can each have this on their computer, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many can run at once?
Oh.
In the same game?
It's fun now because this latest version has spiders. So you can have up to 6 spiders in addition to the main consoles. So they're like all.
So they're all blowing things up while the other guys are trying to organize.
Same game.
Mm-hmm.
Did I see on the website it can be run entirely from an Android?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, so you have Android and I'm trying to think of the other one.
Can you sit here and watch it with me?
Yeah, Linux.
It's at home.
On the home. Don't know what that means, but let me see. I don't know. Let's find out.
All right. So here is our scout ship, and we're docked with the station. And so when I'm doing the captaincy, I would say on Allie's screen, she's got her view, which is so she's got little controls for going left or right, and then she's also got a helm. So Allie just push a bunch of buttons. So she can turn.
Do I hit ready to play? Do I hit ready to play? Well,
oh, yes, yes.
Sorry.
So I hit that?
Maybe I didn't go.
I'm right here.
Yeah, it's good. Try to disconnect from the server, and I'm going to have you pop back in. Can you push everything? There we go. So, you do science and weapons. Okay, is it ready to play? There you go. So they both have a very similar display. Doc has the weapons. So let's go try to find the bad guy. Now, Doc has the science station.
Yes.
So if you click on the science tab, there's all the bad guys. So Ali, can you bring us to 090? And she's going to say, how the heck do I do that? The fun part for this, for
you
me...
You want me to move up so you don't have to walk quite as far?
Well, it's good exercise, but sure, come on up.
We'll be right behind her so we can see what she's doing.
Such a
beard. Well, I got to get my coat back in here.
Okay. That's fine. I'll speed the side back. Okay. Yeah, so you come to 090, which is over here, and you can either use the controls here, or you can also touch that part of the screen, and it'll turn you in that direction. And then bringing up speed is a matter of moving that...
When do I start blowing things up?
Oh, I'm going to get you to blow up land very quickly.
Okay, good. Look at that. So this is your navigator, right?
Mm-hmm. it's not perfect. You can't run through stuff, which I'm kind of glad because my kids aren't the best drivers.
Exactly.
So bring us up to warp, and that's the green one. That one goes really fast.
Oh, look at it go. See?
Jesse, slow down.
From the US, yeah. DS3.
Yeah, and come to all stop. So bring it down. We must destroy things. Okay. Turn, Allie, turn us around. We're going to try to go to that station that we just saw a second ago. So you'll have to warp again.
Look at that.
So with some of the students that I'm working with, one's 9 years old, and he just didn't have a good sense for the cardinal coordinates of like 090. And so we paused the sim, went to the whiteboard, since it's an instructional classroom, and we drew it out, and he went up, and like I had him mark what the different parts were. I'm like, I'm teaching this kid math.
I didn't expect
to do that. So are we close to the station? Oh, he's close to something. Let's destroy him. He's probably a good guy, but we don't care.
Okay, where is he?
So, you'll see him.
Is he right here?
Yep. And when you look in your weapons board, you're going to see him pretty close by. Yeah. So you can click on him, and that'll target him. Poor guy. And you have to load up weapons. So we're going to load up homing torpedoes, and you press load, load, and that'll fill up both torpedo tubes. So then, yeah. And I like the fact that it takes a few seconds to load the missiles into the torpedoes because it makes you have to think ahead of time.
Right. Right. So the thing is, we identify the flavor, and now here we identify the two.
Okay, so she's ready to fire. So fire both. Well, you'll click on fire.
Oh, you're going to fire?
Yep.
So you're the captain, right?
Yes.
Okay, what's your command? What's your command?
Fire both. I think it's a
passage. A direct hit.
The other one is?
That was the second one right there.
Okay, so we didn't destroy him, so we got to reload torpedoes. Helm, bring us as close as you can.
Should we put a nuke in there?
Yeah.
Can you, like, once you fire, can you load the next? Or do you have to wait until it's fully?
What's that?
Like, so say once it is loaded and then it fires, can you immediately click load again?
Yep. And that's some of the initiative of the like the captain and the hunter for the weapons. Like I say, just keep loading with nukes, and then it goes down and just adds another nuke. Yeah. Now, destroyed us.
Oh, destroyed us too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, you fired like, so too close.
Okay, let's come on back. I can try so close.
All right, right. So we're gonna try it again.
From a distance, we could have moved, right?
Yeah, probably.
That's great. I'm going to do a carrier, too.
Unlimited lives. You can learn through experience. Otherwise, you have to read the directions.
All right. So there's our carrier.
It does that. Kids
specifically like that. Yeah, guys are really...
All right. So you're back in the game. Now you're in a carrier. So I'm going to add for both of these stations, if you go back into options, and then back to console choice screen, I'm going to give you fire as well. So fire, and I'm ready to play, because I'll jump back in.
Ooh, that's great. That's what we're seeing.
Oh, that's nice.
Okay, and then on this one also, we're going to do option, and back to console choice screen, and fire. And ready to play, because you're going to get all those stations. Okay, so, now, the fun part is, since this is a carrier, we can launch fighters. And Ali, I'll have you launch your fighter. So, if you click on that tab.
No, that's not a fighter.
Not that one, but you'll see the fighter in a second. So, launch this top fighter. It's almost like you're in a drone. So, now, did she launch out and just not see it? So now if you do these, my kids have the fire control way better than I do. So A and D.
Is this the fire?
I think we are. Happens. Okay, so the only difficulty of them being fighters is now they're not manning their regular stations. So I would have to get her to switch back to the helm in order to do anything. But then that fire is just sort of sitting out there.
Right.
And that's why it's a lot more helpful to have multiple people playing.
So are you talking 8, 12? 27?
I'd say 12 per bridge now is the upper limit. And even there, that captain has to control all those people. Mm-hmm. So now we're experimenting with the ROTC students that are doing this. They're having a captain and what's called a conning officer. So the captain's in the back observing everything, and it's the conning officer who's actually giving the commands. So they're the ones who are coming up with those ideas to try to make it easier to run a bridge that size.
Is it the ROTC that's coming in on Thursday nights?
No, it's local kids who are coming in on Thursday nights. ROTC I do once a year, and they want to come in for more. It's just a matter of getting a time where all of them are available.
Sure.
But what a great team building exercise.
Now, can they do it from a distance? I would imagine they do it from a distance.
Yep.
They usually have each person in a different city.
The
communication would have to be through
a headset. I think in Zoom would be a great way to have everybody linked together.
Yeah, that would probably slow things down drastically.
That's true.
So let's see where.
Yeah, not
so
true.
If you were to do this like you would if you were playing a game console,
and then, like,
where you've got gaming headphones on and you'd be yelling at each other and stuff.
Yeah, that's the next level that they want to go to, is having that integrated communication within the game itself, so like VoIP and mm-hmm. That can actually happen on the game console.
Sure.
Yeah, so that's Artemis. You can see it's for the setup. There's really not a lot to it. It doesn't take a high-end graphics card for most of the uh-huh. games, or for the stations, except the one that's the server. It does help if that's a little bit higher end, because the 3D graphics on the slow machine will kind of chop. But I typically will run my laptop as the good one, and then any other device that we've connected has worked fine as the rest of the bridge. So I would love to answer any questions you've got later on. I'm up at the University of Northern Iowa, and I have a site for this.
Do you have a business card that you can pass out?
Oh, I don't.
You don't. Oh, he should have a business card.
How do you like the program? That's what I'm going to start next year.
What's that?
You're in the instructional education for technology.
Yeah.
Are you finishing it now?
Yeah, I finished it, and my portfolio is online, and it's got the Starship Bridge Simulator on it.
Yeah.
So, I will. Yeah, I will post this. I will post this to the iTech group so that everybody can get access to it. And again, if you have extra questions, you can just Google me, Rob Green, UNI, and I'll pop up. I'm one of the staff there.
Rob.Green, isn't it?
Yeah, rob.green@uni.edu. And if you Google Rob Green, Cedar Falls, I'm the only one.
He's always that place.
So, even though it's a fairly common name, it's not common in Cedar Falls, fortunately.
That's a really cool portfolio.
Hey.
I think you gotta show that around, too.
Hey, I think that's really good. I'm a web developer full-time, so I couldn't just use a
program. And so we're coming up with that.
All right, well, thank you so much for coming. You're welcome to hang out with me.